is chapter 2 of Mark's Gospel, chapter 2 and verse 1 down through 12. And it says that, "And again he entered into Capernaum after some days, and it was noised that he was in the house. And straightway many were gathered together, insomuch that there was no room to receive him." Now, they had already heard about him, and they had already heard what miracles he had done and what things that he had performed and all. And they wanted to get there. They heard Jesus was back in town. They wanted to get there. Now, that's how the churches ought to be today, if they could just hear the gospel of Jesus Christ and they could just see and hear the miracles that Jesus can do. You would think that the churches would be absolutely running over today, because we need to get to see somebody or get to pray to somebody. That's the way we do. We pray through read our Bibles, and we pray to him. But you would think that they would want to get to Jesus today, because everybody that I know of needs a miracle of some sort. Everybody I know of needs a healing of some sort. Everybody I know of has a problem that they need to help with to get over the problem. So it was noised in the house that he was there, and it was told that he was there. Church, we're failing in telling people that they need to come to the house of the Lord, that they need to be in the house of the Lord, or they need to be, if the gospel of Jesus Christ is not being preached here, if the gospel of Jesus Christ is not being sent out, and if the power of the Holy Spirit is not here, then they need to be in some church where the power of the Holy Spirit is at, to where that they can be fed and where they can be healed, delivered, and set free and saved by the word and the power of the Holy Spirit of God. Now, I say that, and I say that this morning, because a lot of times, and I have said this before, and I say it again, as Sammy said, I'm not really in the mood to try to make friends this morning. I want to get you the Word of God, and I want to tell you that Jesus Christ can take care of anything you may be going through. But also, I want to tell you that what's happened now, and what's happened in our world today, and all our churches have turned out to just be opera houses or to be theaters, because it's all theatrical, it's all smoke and mirrors now and all, and Jesus Christ is left out. But I'm telling you here this morning that Jesus Christ is the center of this story. Jesus Christ is the center of this church, and we need to worship him in spirit and truth, and we need to preach the word of God, and we need to preach exactly what Jesus Christ preached when he preached. He went around preaching the kingdom of God is at hand, the power of God, what God could do, and the salvation of God. That's preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ right there. That's simple. Now you say, well, some preachers does it different than others. Yes, they do. But I'm telling you, that is the message this morning, that we as born again Christians need to get out to other people and let them know that there's hope this morning in Jesus Christ. And he was preaching this same message when he went through those towns and went through those tours. He was preaching about the kingdom of God. Bless God that we preach the kingdom of God. The kingdom of God is at hand. Man, Jesus Christ is coming back just any day now. And just any day we could be with him in what? In his kingdom this morning, if we're born again children of God. We need to be preaching that the power of God. God's still in the healing business. God's still in delivering business. And God can still work a miracle for you this morning. And we need to be preaching that. And not only that, there is salvation in God this morning through his Son Jesus Christ. And as Sammy mentioned about giving this morning and all, I'm not going there. I'm not going to touch that one. But we need to let these children know and let these folks know that has missed out on the Word of God, that there is salvation in Jesus Christ. That there's only two places that you're going to spend eternity, and one of them is a place called heaven if you know Jesus Christ, and the other is a place called hell if you reject Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. Now, I'll be like Ron. Ron says, he says he's worse than I am. He'll say amen for himself. You listen to him on Wednesday night, he'll say amen 100 times. I only said about 50 times this morning, Chuck. But nevertheless, anyway, Jesus now, it's noise, he's in the house. He's noise, he's there. And straightway, many of them gathered together. Verse 2, if you're trying to follow along with me, verse 2, chapter 2. They just gathered together inasmuch that there was no room to receive them. No, not so much as about the door. And here again, let's stop for just a minute. Here now, he's back in town. And he's tried to sneak back in town. And now it got told, and it's noise, that he's in the house. Now the house is full. They're so full, they're standing around. There are people shoulder to shoulder throughout the whole house. They're standing around to where not another person can squeeze in. Now that's what I'm talking about, togetherness. Now they're not social distancing at all right here in this house. They wasn't social distancing and all there. They were standing like this, and they were together and on top of one another. And they were there because, number one, half of them wanted to hear the word of God. Half of them wanted to hear the preaching of the word of God. The other half were curious as to see what he was going to do and see some of the miracles he was going to do and see some of the things that he was going to do, and also to be critical when he did do some miracles there. So it's kind of the same way today, kind of like churches are today. About half are here to really worship God. The other half are here just to see what's going on and see what's happening and see if they what they like and don't like. You know, that's just exactly the way congregations are today. But that's all right, because those that come just to see, sometimes they come just being curious, and sometimes the Holy Spirit will get a hold of them and they'll get saved, and guess what? They turn out to be one of those that come to praise and worship. So that's what you got to do. You got a noise, he's in the house. But look what happened there. He's in the house and there's no room in there. And what did he do? He didn't break out in a song, and there's nothing wrong. I love singing, by the way. There's nothing wrong with that. He didn't break out in a song. What did he say he done? He preached to them. He done exactly what look, he gets a full house, and instead of saying, well, we're just going to have a good party and a good time here tonight and all, we're going to sing a bunch of songs and then we're going to go home. He started preaching to them the word of God. Again, what he preached, kingdom of God, power of God, salvation of God. That's what he preached to this congregation here. And so what happens is, now the house is full, he's preaching the word, and now they come to him bringing one sick of a palsy. Verse number 3. Now I want you to pay close attention to this one, because this is one I'll come back to and I'm going to elaborate on. And yeah, I've got plenty of time. You see that? I've got plenty of time, because my watch is in my pocket over here. I've got plenty of time, Robert. But nevertheless, there, here we go. They come unto him bringing one sick of the palsy. In other words, the old boy couldn't walk. And says they, which was, and I'm in King James, you can, whatever version you got, it'll still give you the same thing. It says, which was born of 4. In other words, what's happening here is got an old boy that can't walk. And here they've heard about Jesus. They've heard about him being in the house. And here it is. They make them up a cot or a gurney of some type. And there's one, each one gets on each corner. And here we go down the road. We're going to take him down to where Jesus is at. And we're going to carry him down there. Hold on to that thought, because in a minute I'm coming back to that one right there. So here they come. Now there's 4 of them carrying him. The old boy can't walk a bit. And he's just laying there. And his friends are bringing him. Now it says, and they come to him, bringing him. And when they had could not come in nigh unto him for the press, in other words, too big a crowd, they couldn't even get in. They couldn't even push themselves in the door. And it says they uncovered the roof where he was. Now, in this time and all, real hurriedly, in this time in which they lived and all, they had flat roofs. They had a ladder that walked up to the roof. A lot of times they went up there and sat and laid and whatever they wanted to do up there and all. They wouldn't have the convenience of air conditioning or heat or whatever nowadays and so on. But anyways, a flat roof. And it was kind of pitched and had tar or had clay shingles made on it and all, and that's how that the roof was made. These old boys up there, they couldn't get in. They couldn't get in the door with their friend that they had carried for miles, and they couldn't get in the door. And they sit down, instead of sitting down, and like some of us do today, we give up before our breakthrough comes through. We give up and we give in a little bit too early, because I'll tell you what, don't give up on God, because He won't give up on you. But well, they didn't just throw the old boy down or set him down on the ground and say, well, we can't get in, place is full, and we've carried you up here, and I don't know how you're going to get back, but we can't get you back, because we ain't carrying you back. You're too heavy, buddy. You've been eating too much. You weigh too much, and we're not carrying you back. That's not what his friends done to him. They got to looking. They said, well, we can't get in. We can't push in the door. There's no way we can get into Jesus. Now, what are we going to do? And one of them said, well, let's carry him up on top of the roof. And let's carry him up there. And let's carry him up there, and let's just tear off the shingles, and let's tear off the roof there, and let's lower him down. Now, let me tell you something. Sometimes you say, well, preacher, it ought to be made easy for us. It ought to be made to where that we shouldn't have to put forth an effort. Well, Jesus Christ put forth an effort on the cross when He died on the cross. He sure put forth an effort. And for us, sometimes we need to go through a little bit. We need to go through just a little bit of hard time to get a real blessing or get a real healing sometimes. Amen. But anyway, the old boys and all, they said, well, they couldn't get through, so they uncovered the roof where he was, and there, when they had broken it up, they let him down the bed wherein the sick, the palsy lay. When Jesus saw their faith, he said unto the sick of a palsy, son, thy sins be forgiven. Now, I've got to work this story just exactly like the Lord gave it to me. Now, first and foremost, I'm going to tell you something. Not only was there some critics there, and I'm going to read about them if I get to it in just a minute. Not only was the scribes sitting there to see what they could see that they may go against Jesus Christ with. Not only were they sitting there, but his friends now, when Jesus made that statement, son, thy sins be forgiven, they're saying, wait a minute, Lord. We carried our friend all this distance. We tore this roof off. We let him down. We want the old boy to walk. We don't care about his sins. We want him to be able to walk. We wanted to have a miracle. But Jesus Christ was like he is for you and I today. He's thinking more on in here and taking care of healing our heart than he is healing our body. But then he will heal our body. Don't get me wrong. He will heal our body. But he healed this old boy, his heart. He healed him first. But I'm sure his friends are standing there, as I said, they're standing there saying, whoa, man, I want him to be able to walk out of here instead of just his sins be forgiven. But let's read this a little bit more. But there were certain scribes sitting there and reasoning in their hearts, why doeth this man speak blasphemies? Who could forgive sins but God only? And immediately when Jesus perceived in his spirit that they so reasoned within themselves, he said unto them, why reason ye these things in your heart? In other words, why are you sitting over there talking these things? And why are you sitting over there saying these things? And here's his answer. He says, whether it's easier to say the sick of the palsy, thy sins be forgiven thee, or arise, take up thy bed and walk. Now, get this, and Jesus, and I'm going to hurriedly get through this right quick if I can. But Jesus now, the scribes is over there, and they don't believe he is the Messiah. They don't believe he is a bit more than nothing. So they're sitting over there saying, well, you're just mocking God. You're just in here. Who can forgive sins? And Jesus looks at them boys and he says, well, listen, which would be easier? And this blows their mind, because they're supposed to be the ones that knows it all and knows the word and all. It blows their mind. He said, what's easier, for me to say thy sins be forgiven, or get up and walk, boy? Amen. Amen. He says, which is easier? And they're still looking at him now. I believe if you look into it and read your commentaries now, they're still looking at him and they're still saying, well, either one's easy. You would have to be of God to do either one of them. Watch what he does. He says, but that you may know that the Son of Man hath power on earth to forgive sins. Now, that remark he's making right directly to the old boy that can't walk. Because you see it in the King James, it's in parentheses. He says to the sick of the palsy, he says, do you believe that I'm the Son of God, that I can forgive your sins? The old boy had to answer him, yes. And says in verse 11, I say unto thee, now your sins are forgiven. Now I say unto you, arise. Now these scribes, remember, they're sitting over here saying, can't do neither one of them things, lest it be of God. Well, guess what? They couldn't see what was in here, but they're going to see this next part of this miracle. They're going to witness this next part of this thing, because they say here now, he says, immediately, or I say unto thee, arise, take up thy bed and go thy way into thy house. Well, at that particular time, his four friends absolutely went, well, we don't have to carry him back to the house. That's what they were thinking. But them scribes over there sitting over there with their mouth open, because not only did he forgive him of his sins, but then he told him, get up, and he performed that great miracle to where he was able to walk back home. And it says, immediately, when Jesus spoke those words, immediately the old boy rose up and took up his bed and went forth before them all, insomuch that they were all amazed and glorified God, saying, we never saw it in this fashion. Now let me say this. Those folks that was in the house, that was packed in the house, that was there to serve God, they broke out. They broke out in revival. I mean to tell you, they began to worship God. They began to praise God. Because they had this witness to him, forgive him of his sins. But not only forgive him of his sins, but speak the word and he walked. I'm telling you, they were absolutely on top. They left that house that night feeling great, saying, boy, it was good to be there. I hope he has another revival tomorrow night. I hope church is here tomorrow night. I'm going to come. I'm going to see what happens. But immediately he took up his bed and went forth before them all, insomuch that they were amazed, glorified God, saying, we never seen it in this fashion. Now, the reason I read that to you the second time, I want you to understand something. If you and I would just let God work through each and every one of us, according to the power that worketh in us, if we would just praise him like we've never praised him before, if we would just thank him like we've never thanked him before, if we would just do that, and worship in spirit and in truth, I'm telling you, the rest of the house would be sitting in awe. And they'd be sitting there, as Beverly says, I do. And sometimes I'll be sitting there like this. She says, I sit there like that. I said, that's just for old people that does that. And Chuck, she says, I do that. But anyway, they would be sitting there like that. And we would see some people saved. We'd see some people healed. We'd see some people delivered. Just like Miss Christie, 2 years. We'd see more of that than what we're seeing right now. Amen. If we would just absolutely accept the power of God and accept the Spirit of God. Yes. Now, real hurriedly, and I've still got time. See, it's not, you normally don't get out of here at 12:30 for me, you that's visiting. But I'm going to try to finish you up early just because them other two boys has run off on us, okay? And they usually let you out 12:15. I want you real hurriedly to look at something for me. I told you back in the chapter 2 and verse number 3, it says, they came unto him bringing one sick of a palsy, which was bore of four. Yeah. Four friends. Now I want you to do me a favor when you go home, every one of you, and then I'll finish the message. I want you to do this. Once you go home, I don't care whether you make a rectangle, whether you make a square, I don't care what you make, something with four corners on it. Now I want you to draw a circle on each corner. And I want you to put a name at each corner. If you have four people that if you were in a mess like this boy was, couldn't walk, if you were down and out, if you were hurting, they would carry you like these guys did to Jesus. So I want you to, when you go home, that's your homework for when you go home today. Just make a square, four corners, I want you to see. Because I've been told myself, I've been told that if in a lifetime you can have five true friends in a lifetime, that is great. Amen. Now I'm going back to one true friend is Jesus Christ. But I want you to do that for me. I want you to see if you have four. If you do, you're a privileged person. If you do, you are absolutely a blessed person. But let's look at real hurriedly. Let's look at right quick. If I can find this right here. Yes, these four friends. I gave each one of them because if you notice something here in this story, those four friends are not mentioned by name. They're not mentioned, you know, Joe, Bill, nothing is mentioned about. They get no glory, none whatsoever. The only glory they get was they got glory when they seen their friend healed. They got glory when they seen him going down the road. So they got glory then. But friend number one, I'm going to name him Compassion. And I'm going to, the friend had seen his friend in need, and not only in need, but he knew that Jesus could help him to get better. And so with that compassion that was inside of him, he knew his friend wasn't getting any better. And so he decided, if we can take him to Jesus, he can get better. Yeah. So compassion. You got to have compassion this morning, folks. Church, we need more compassion. We need more compassion for the sick, for the lost, and for the hurting in our community here and all over the country. But we got to start at home first. And so we need more compassion. The man of compassion is a friend we need to have. Not to be critical of our situation, not to pass judgment on, oh, boy's just laying there, he ain't doing no good. Not to make our situation worse by harmful words, but willing to help and willing to help now. Yes. And not to just leave us lay there, but to be concerned with our situation and get others to help also. That's compassion. And there's all kinds of scriptures and all, but for time purposes, Psalms 86:15 talks about compassion. Psalms 111 verses 1 through 4 talks about compassion of God. 1 Peter 3:8 talks about the having compassion one for another. So it's all in the scriptures. Friend number two, I want to name him Faith. Because like Peter and John that was talked to the lame man at the gate, they said, silver and gold have I none, but such as I have, I give unto you, which is Jesus Christ. Now, this morning, I want to say this. Faith, you got to believe God can do something to even have faith. We've got some people here in our church that are sick, facing some serious things. You got to have the faith before you can pray and ask God to touch them. You've got to have the faith before that you can be serious enough to even help them in any way. But the woman that had the issue of blood, she had the faith. She said, if I could just get to Jesus and if I could just touch the hem of his garment. So this kind of faith only works in those who believe. I've told you 100 times from this pulpit, if you don't believe, you don't receive. Amen. So, I don't know about you, but I want people who believe and know the power of God and the faith praying and helping me if I've got a problem. I want them to believe that God can work on my behalf. Because I certainly believe that he can. Bible says that faith cometh by hearing. You got to hearing the word of God. And I could go on with scripture after scripture, but I want you to just I want to leave this one with you. Ephesians 3:17 says that Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith, that you being rooted and grounded in love. And then the other one that I want to get to, if I can, I won't get to the number three person. I named him determination or will. That we know there were no doubt tired from carrying their friend. They had to be. As I said a while ago, I said it kind of jokingly, but they had to be worn out from carrying him across town and carrying. Because I'm going to tell you something. Dead weight, you take dead weight, 200 pounds, laying on a mat, and you try carrying that. Dead weight's hard to carry. And carrying somebody on a stretcher. So they had to be worn out. They had to be worn out. But, listen, they had the determination to get him there. They had the determination to rip the roof off. They had determination to get him to Jesus, the source that could fix his problem. So it says in 2 Peter 3:9, the Lord is not slack concerning his promise, as some men count slackness, but is long-suffering toward us, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. Even though it's hard and the road gets heavy, press on. Amen. Keep on. Amen. Some of you may be sitting here today and saying, man, I don't know, I can go another step farther. Keep on. Amen. Keep on. Your breakthrough is just right around the corner.
Come on.
Your breakthrough, if you're seeking Jesus Christ for help, is just around the corner. And so your blessing, your breakthrough, whatever you want to call it this morning, is right around the corner. So, friend number four, I named him love. God's love is not a pampering love. Now, you know, I say that, and some people take me wrong here, so let me say this, you know. We'll go around sometimes as Christians, and we'll go around, we see somebody that's really going through a struggle or going through a problem, we'll say, bless your heart. Bless your heart. And that's all we do for them. Well, honey, listen. You need to pray for them. But if there's something you can do, if you can grab a hold of one corner of their mat or their bed and carry it, grab hold.
Amen.
Instead of just saying, I'll pray for you. Bless your little heart. That ain't going to help you none. You know, if I was laying here in the middle of this floor right here this morning, and I couldn't move, and four people walked up here, and two people said, bless his heart. And the other two picked him up, you know what they'd do? They'd roll me right out on the floor. Think about that. So, it's not a pampering, it's a perfecting love. God's love is. His friends had this very thought. Get him perfected. In other words, get him healed. And the only one we know that can heal him is Jesus Christ. Let's get him to him. We need to get that attitude about all of our lost loved ones. I could ask every one of you this morning. Every one of you would have to raise your hand, including me, that has lost loved ones. We would have to say, we have them. Well, you know what? Pray and some way get them to Jesus.
Amen.
One amen. Get them to Jesus. So, not only did they get what they desired to get their friend healed, but even more than that, they got more than they expected. Remember what I said? His sins were forgiven and he got to walk. Amen. Now, I'm coming down to what you want to say, praise the Lord for. I'm going to close. So if it was just compassion holding one corner of the bed, they would not have made it. If it was just faith holding just one corner of the bed, they would not have made it. If it was determination or will holding one corner of the bed, they would not have made it. If it was just love holding one corner of the bed, they would not have made it. It takes all of us doing our part to get the job done this morning. It takes the whole church. And when I say the whole church, the whole group of baptized believers, if they will come together. Now, I know the scripture says if two or three are gathered in my name, I'll be in the midst, and you can turn things over here on earth and in heaven, and you can shake heaven and move them and all. But I'm going to tell you, it's much better when you got 20 or 30, or when you got 200 or 300, or 2,000 or 3,000. It's much better, and you get lots more results. So this morning, I'm going to go right back to what I said to start with. We had lots of people in our church and in our church family that has got sicknesses, disease, problems, heartaches. And I'm going to ask you this morning, are you one of the four? Are you one of the four that needs to be carrying that one to the altar, carrying that one to Jesus? You say, well, preacher, what's one person going to do? What's one person going to do? Well, again, going back to those four, they could have each one said that and nobody done anything. And that's what's happening nowadays in our churches. Everybody's saying, well, since COVID, ain't as many people here as what there was. Well, you know what? How many have you invited to come with you? How many have you encouraged to come with you? How many lost people? I don't want you going to other churches and getting people. That's not the right thing to do. And I've always preached against that. I won't even try to get people from other churches at all to come to our church if they have a permanent home church. Now, if they don't have a regular home church that they're happy with, I'm all over them. I'm all over them. If they're lost, I'm all over them. We need to absolutely be doing what God has called you to do. I don't know what your job is. I don't know what corner it is you're supposed to carry. I will say this. Not every one of us has the same job. Not every one. I can't do the job you're supposed to do. You say, well, preacher, you're supposed to do it all. That's the problem. Everybody's got that mindset that the preacher can do it all. I can't walk on water, okay? I will just have to confess to you this morning, I can't walk on water. But I can't do a lot of things. But I can do a lot of things if I've got a lot of people that faith believe in, love, compassion, faith, carrying the load. We can continue to carry the load.
Yes.
Now, sum it up. Have you got anybody that you need to bring to Jesus this morning? You say, well, preacher, wait, I need three more to help me carry. Yeah, you do. But guess what? You're going to have to pick up your end first. You're going to have to take the first step. You're going to have to make, and then there'll be one of these people that believe. They'll come pray with you. And before you know it, there'll be four praying with you. I guarantee you. I'll guarantee you. You say, oh, I don't want to embarrass myself. I don't want to embarrass them. I don't need to know who they are. I don't need to know what their problem is. You need to bring it to Jesus this morning and give it to Him. You need to bring your friend to Jesus. You need to bring your loved one to Jesus this morning. You need to bring your situation to Jesus this morning. You need to start. Do what you can. And watch God work. That's why we're not seeing. You say, well, preacher, you speak of these miracles and all, but that was back then and this is now. Well, I will give you just a little scripture to take home with you, just along with your homework. He says, I'm the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. I changeth not. I believe it's the King James. I changeth not. So God hasn't changed. Believe it or not, in 2,000 years since Jesus preached the message here, the message hadn't changed. It's still preaching the kingdom of God, and it is at hand. The power of God, God can do all things. And the salvation of God, God can save anybody. And that salvation is through His Son, Jesus Christ. That's the message. So this morning, This altar is open for you if you'd like to come. If you stand with me, Ms. Elva comes and sings a song for you. If you stand with me, unless you have to run to the bathroom or you have to go, please just kindly stand quietly. Someone may be in the valley of decision. Someone may be deciding whether to accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior or not. Somebody may be wanting to bring their friend to the altar. Someone may be wanting to be prayed for this morning. Someone may have this need that Jesus can feel. I don't want to waste your time, but I don't want you to leave here this morning just that close to your breakthrough, that close to your miracle this morning, because of your stubbornness or because that you say, well, I'll wait some other time. I want to read something to you that break your heart. And this gentleman, he drives a tractor and trailer over the road, long haul. He doesn't get to come to church. He just comes in just every once in a while. But I want to read something to you. This came on Friday, I believe it was. And the reason I'm reading it to you, he wanted somebody to carry their corner. He wanted somebody to carry. But anyway, this is it's a long story, but I wanted to read you the name. The little girl's name is Leela Swan, S-W-A-I-N. She's at Children's Hospital in Charleston. They took her to one in Charleston. That's where she lives. She's just at the point of death. A mysterious disease just hit her all of a sudden. And you know what? What happened was the family members, when that happened, they wanted somebody to carry the bed. They wanted somebody to carry her name to Jesus Christ for a healing. She needs a touch. She's in bad shape. It goes on and on and on, telling me all about it. And I said, we will certainly pray for you and pray for her. She's 9 years old. And now, here's the syndrome. It's called OMS. Come on all of a sudden. I can't say OPSOCLONAUS MYOCLONUS syndrome. It's a neurological disease. If you're 9-year-old this morning, if you're 19-year-old this morning, if you're 39-year-old this morning, had that problem, could you carry the corner of the bed this morning? Would you carry the corner of the bed this morning? If you need to pray for any reason, I'm going to ask you to come. If you want to come, unite with the church, you want to come and just pray for anything. Pray for one of your loved ones. If you need to be saved, I'm going to ask you to come. You say, why in the world, preacher, you waste so much time with the altar call? Because if somebody could be in the valley of a decision, but there could be somebody here that if one person would step out and pray for them and let somebody else gather with them and pray and agree and touch him, somebody could be healed, somebody could be delivered or set free today. Please don't miss this opportunity. Go ahead, Miss.